Bring in then Peter McGuire, CEO at exim.com, to put all of this together for us. Peter, welcome to the show and thanks very much for joining in. Let me first start by, you know, getting your take on the entire Iran sanction waiver issue, because this was a six-month extension essentially that had been given by Donald Trump, a select group of countries that import heavily from Iran, including the likes of India. What is the expectation at this stage? Are you anticipating there will be no further extension given?
Well, good morning. Thanks for inviting me on the show. Yes, I think when you think of what John Bolton's been trying to achieve, and he didn't think that those waivers were had any weight at all, they expire on the 2nd of May, and how that moves forward after that. There's been talk on and chat in media over the last, you know, matter of a day or so, and we're pretty sure that if it moves forward and they're able to really hit Iran hard, I'm sure that that's going to, and that's been demonstrated in the last matter of a couple of hours as far as price spikes. It'll continue to the upside. So, like it or not, it's going to impact, I think, crude pricing, and it's going to have an impact on those countries that have been buying cheaper crude. Saudis might come to the an increased supply, but it's just going to be a wait and see at the moment.
All right, it is all about supply. So let's start by talking about that. I think some of the concerns that we were talking about on the demand side of things have now been put on the back burner for the moment. We've seen a 30% year-to-date rally in crude prices. There was a lot of concern as we closed out the last calendar year about you know, where we could see crude prices trade for most of 2019. But it does look like things are looking more bullish than we perhaps expected at that point in time. In terms of the OPEC supply cuts, what is your baseline expectation and where really do you expect that will then push crude prices purely on the supply side factors?
Well, I think it's going to push it up. There's no doubt that from a supply side, you know, there's so many different moving parts and we're heading into the Northern Hemisphere summer. So you traditionally have, you know, large spikes as far as demand picture. Also, you need to take on board that with the likes of Venezuela, we're seeing what's happening in Libya as well. These also go into the melting pot in the sense of those Iran issues. So at the present, we've got hedge funds all over crude. They're going to start stacking positions even more aggressively to the upside, I'm sure. It's been such a huge rally since Christmas. And as you mentioned, you know, we haven't seen these prices since early November. So it's been a one-way traffic since Christmas. It's been an almighty trade. And at the present, I think that there's probably further upside. Try and get a handle as far as dollar. I wouldn't be surprised for Brent to take 75 out sometime before the end of this month.
All right. We spoke about, you know, Iran, but I think geopolitics continues to dominate the supply side concerns at the moment. Venezuela and Libya, these are the two unknowns at this point, and they might really be the big disruptors as we move forward from here. These are countries that were exempted from the OPEC supply cuts, you know, when they had put those in place earlier for the year. What is the expectation? Do you expect that we could see some massive disruption that hasn't yet been priced in by the oil market, either from Venezuela or the likes of Libya?
Well, I think from the first part of it, OPEC will take an aggressive stance as far as to try and make any shortfalls and what impact that has to market. Naturally, OPEC want higher pricing and there's no, they've been very, very satisfied even since March 18 in Azerbaijan, the meeting I attended. That was quite fascinating because it's been a solid uptick in that last month. And there's a next meeting about this time next month in Jeddah in Saudi Arabia, a JMMC meeting. And I'm sure that that's going to also be, you know, fairly heavily viewed in quite simple terms, because there's been such a strong recovery. OPEC is now looking far more robust, and they're really quite satisfied, I think, with this pricing and even, you know, higher from here. So it's all about what happens, the geopolitics of it all as well, and where do these sanctions and are there going to be, you know, waivers or not going to be waivers from the Trump administration.
All right, just for the sake of argument, Peter, you know, is there any sort of anticipation that if things get too tight as far as the oil market goes, either on account of the kind of disruptions you mentioned in Libya or even the sanctions on Venezuela, that we could see the U.S. actually go softer on the likes of Iran, and that in turn would, you know, of course, impact the list of countries that have been given these waivers by the U.S. government? If there is any anticipation that Donald Trump may take into account the fact that oil prices are rising too rapidly, something he has spoken about in the past, could we see any sort of a rollback to their stance on Iran?
Well, I think it's going to greatly impact Iran. There's no doubting that, because it'll have massive effects from an economic side, what it does to the nation, its hard currency, and, of course, political and, you know, instability. that's only going to manifest itself over the next matter of, you know, this summer period. And what concern it has to its own administration and, of course, to its, you know, its economic climate. Now, you know, these sort of sanctions can be very heavily and crippling to any economy. And we all understand where Iran's views are and, of course, where the U.S. administration is. Even to the point, you know, how's India going to get on Japan, China and so on, that are buyers of that crude? I'm sure they'll have to look at other alternatives. And it'll be interesting to see who comes into the from a supply side to make up for any shortfalls.
All right. Of course, we do have to talk about U.S. production because no longer is it Saudi Arabia that's the largest producer. It is all about the U.S. Even as OPEC has introduced these production cuts, it is U.S. that's been shoring up the kind of production that we've seen coming in from them month on month. What is the anticipation as far as U.S. production goes? And do you expect that, we could see any sort of a rollback, at least to the kind of stance that OPEC has taken? If they abandon the deal that we're looking at the moment, could we then see a sharp fall in oil prices?
Well, I think that, you know, collectively, yes, Saudis will come to it, and the other producers, I'm pretty sure. I mean, there's, you know, strong political alignment between Russia and Iran, but that'll be interesting to see if they come to any sort of measure there as far as increasing production. And I'm sure there's plenty of, you know, excess capacity out there for the likes of the heavyweights, being they, of course, Saudis and Russia. So, you know, it's a wait and see, I think, over the next couple of weeks. One thing for sure, it's going to add to price instability, and I think it's further upside for here in the short to medium term. So if we get this week could be very interesting. If there's further movement there that the US comes out, then I'm sure that prices will probably go a couple of dollars higher from here, and what impact that has naturally from the Saudi side as far as supply.
All right, very interesting. Finally, you know, let me just get your sort of a ballpark figure that you are anticipating for crude prices. I know it's always difficult to predict where oil prices move from here, but we've seen a 30, nearly 40% jump coming in for crude prices, including if we look at the likes of WTI and Brent, it stands at nearer to 40% from the kind of lows that we saw earlier on. In just the last 6 months alone, we're seeing demand holding up perhaps better than most analysts had priced in. Where do you see oil prices if we talk about the next 3 months or so?
It's a non-stop affair as far as pricing, and that seems to be very easily demonstrated with the futures market over the last matter of hours and what we've seen over the last, you know, 5 to 6 weeks as far as pricing. This is incredibly bullish, and all of these ingredients are going into the melting pot as far as, you know, higher pricing, because you've got the geopolitical side, you've got Venezuela, you've got Libya, and, of course, you've got the might of Saudis and Russia, of course. Then you've got the other side. You know, US is now the largest producer, and what impact is that going to be naturally to the Trump administration going in for a second term and their electioneering and everything starting, you know, over the next matter of months for, you know, an election in around about 16 months? They want cheaper prices, not higher prices, and this is going to cause, I think, a great degree of concern to naturally the consumer over this Northern Hemisphere summer. So, yes, I think it's going to be higher from here, and I think it's who knows where it can end.